It's on. There we go. All right. Good afternoon. It is an exciting day for the church family here at Fount of Life, and especially for Pastor-elect Lindemann and family. Ordination, installation, a big day. And so we're here then to not just celebrate the person, but to celebrate the ministry that he embarks on, the ministry here in your midst at Fount of Life. The order for worship is laid out both in the worship folder as well as up on the screen. You can follow along with whichever you're more comfortable with. We begin with our opening hymn. It's a reminder of in whose name we are gathered. It's hymn 532, God is here as we his people. We sing it together. Please stand. We join in the responsive call to worship using the words of Psalm 46. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way, and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. We are gathered this afternoon to celebrate Yet the root reason that we're gathered is that we daily need the very thing that this ministry here at Fount of Life is centered on. The grace of God shown most clearly in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. So let us admit our need, trusting in God's unfailing love. Heavenly Father, I am altogether sinful from birth. That sin in my heart leads me to sin against others and against you more than I know. Even worse, it leads me to think that your mercy is something I only need occasionally. Forgive me for my attitude and actions that make Jesus' life, death, and resurrection anything less than vital for my daily and eternal life. Lead me to the forgiveness you graciously give, and help me to treasure your life-giving word each day. God has had mercy on us, washed us, and forgiven us. He did this all by sending his only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to pay the price for all our sins. Through faith in Jesus, God's gift to you is a clean conscience, a pure heart, and the sure hope of eternal life in heaven. May God strengthen and equip you now as you seek to speak, think, and live in ways that honor him. Amen. We pray. Almighty God, look with favor on those whom you've called to minister to your people. Fill them with faithfulness to your doctrine and clothe them with your righteousness each day, that they may joyfully serve to the glory of your name and for the benefit of your church. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We hear a duet of the anthem, Here I Am, Lord.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts to live alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide. till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you will hold your people in my heart. I will hold your people in my heart.
Noon for this installation service is a fitting one. It was a change of leadership for God's people. God had used Moses, right, to lead his people out of Egypt for 40 years during the wandering in the wilderness, but now they were going into the promised land, and it was a new leader time. And that was a big task, right? Joshua had watched Moses lead for a long time, and he had to have been nervous, not just because he was following in big shoes, but just because it's a big job, bringing God to God's people. And that's why God gives these words of encouragement to Joshua and to your pastor. We read from Joshua chapter 1. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give you to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon, and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. This is God's word. Our second scripture reading is speaking directly to elders, to those in spiritual authority over God's people. And yet, I bet there's a verse that you recognize. It's the last one. As God speaks to his shepherds of his flock, the leaders of his people, he gives a whole list of encouragements, of reminders, of strengthening encouragements, and then he reminds them, and I've got this. I've got this, not you. You just do the job I've given you. Bring all the rest, all the baggage, all the struggles, all the challenges, bring it all to me, to God. We read from 1 Peter chapter 5. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who will also share in the glory to be revealed. Because shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. This is the Word of God. We join in singing our next hymn, hymn number 542, Dear Lord, to your true servants give.
Grace and peace to you from God our Heavenly Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our sermon text this afternoon is found in the Gospel of John 14, verses 22 through 24, from the ESV. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, what has happened that you are going to show yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, If anyone loves me, he will hold on to my word. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. The one who does not love me does not hold on to my words. The word that you are hearing is not mine, but it is from the Father who sent me. This is our text. Dear people of God, dear brothers in the ministry, and my dear son, Jesus answered good Judas' question. He didn't always do that, like with Nicodemus in John 3. Many times when people asked Jesus a question, he would just use it to lead them somewhere else, to dig deeper into another topic, like poor Nicodemus trying to learn about baptism. But here, Jesus did answer good Judas' question. Now, maybe you didn't get the answer when it was read, and maybe you couldn't reproduce it to someone else. But he did answer it. Now, this is good Judas, not bad Judas. There were two Judases among the 12. This is not the Judas who betrayed Jesus within 24 hours. This is not the Judas who is from the Judean town of Kerioth. And so this guy gets the cruddy label of Judas not Iscariot. He asked Jesus, really in essence, Lord, why do we know who you are? And we believe in you, but it looks like nobody else does. That's the essence of his question. And Jesus' answer is really the word. It's about the Word of God. And then Jesus shows us that the Word really isn't His Word, it's the Father's Word coming through Him. And then the Holy Spirit takes that Word and He implants it in people's hearts. He says that in the next part of the chapter that we didn't get to. That it's the Holy Spirit working through Word, the Word of God, and the sacraments along with it that make you believers. That's why you're here. You have the Word. And you love the Word. And you use the Word. Which means, as Jesus says, you have the Trinity in you. Now, Pastor Lindemann, you are here in this church at this point in your life because, as you said at my anniversary in the ministry, you wanted to be closer to Jesus and learn more about Him. Those were your words. I didn't tell you to say that. I didn't make you be a pastor. That's on you. The Holy Spirit guided your life to bring you to this point. That's not my doing. But I want to tell you, son, you've chosen well. You get to use your time, mainly your mornings, studying this. Studying the very Word of God that you love, that you've come to love. And then you'll spend your afternoons and your evenings and your Sunday mornings too, telling it to these people. Telling it to the people of the neighborhood. You'll tell them the mysteries of God that you discover. And they will cling to this wonderful Word of God. That's what a Lutheran pastor is. A Lutheran pastor is a humble student. He knows that he doesn't know it all. But he strives to know everything of Christ. A Lutheran pastor is a gospel proclaimer. He knows that you're not going to listen all the time. And yet he wants you to. He's going to come running to you with a message from the King about God's great love for us sinners. And he's going to be more than happy to tell you about it. And you will rejoice in this word. That's the essence of the job. You all are paying him to study so that he can come and tell you these gems he will mine out of the scripture. Now, what you don't know, and what I know, is how smart and how gifted this young man is. You will enjoy finding that out. You are going to love him. See, right now you love him because he's here. Thank you, Steve. Right now you love him because he's filling your need. He's answered your call that I understand was shouted for a while. But you will come to love him for his mind. You will come to love him for his faith that he will shine among you. Now, he brought with him this little girl that you don't have to love because I love her enough for all of us together. So don't worry about that. But you can love her if you want to. And he's also brought with him his wife, Maggie, who you are going to love because, well, she's just the best. And I'm going to tell you a Maggie story because it's my favorite story and I tell it to anyone who will listen. It was 2 years ago when they vicared over in Montrose across the mountains. And it was October on a Sunday afternoon after the Packer game, of course. And we went out looking for something to eat, a burger and a beer. Then we came to one place and the place we wanted to go was closed. They were closed on Sunday. We went to another place, and they wouldn't let us in with the baby. And so we got back in the car to continue our adventure throughout the town of Montrose, looking for a place we wanted to eat. And I started talking, because that's what I do. And I said, you know, in Wisconsin, the bars let anybody come in because there's already kids inside. And in Wisconsin, a lot of places are open on Sundays on purpose to get the after football traffic. And then Maggie, in the most wonderful way, in their sweet voice, said, "All right, no more Wisconsin talk for the rest of the trip." And she said it so wonderfully that we all giggled and there was no more Wisconsin talk. You will come to love Maggie. But this young man, whom you call pastor, you will love dearly. Because he will bring you the Word of God. He will bring you Jesus and the Father and the Spirit along with it. And more. See, this is how we endure. This is how we make it through this world. With prices gone crazy, the godlessness in the schools and in the courts, the wickedness out on the streets that would make Sodom and Gomorrah blush. How do we do it? How do you get to the end with your faith intact? How do we make it? How do our children make it? All the way to the goal, to paradise, in righteousness and purity forever. It's back to the Word. He's going to bring you this saving Word of God. This Word that flows from the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word that is Jesus Christ Himself. The Word that the Spirit works through. A Word that will drive you to your knees in repentance of all of your sins. And a Word that will lift you up as you hear over and over and over again that Jesus Christ bled and died to win for you, even you, the forgiveness of every one of those sins. You're going to love it. And that's the answer to your question, Judas, not Iscariot. That's why you have Jesus. And that's why the world doesn't. See, it's not that the world doesn't know. You've got a great big cross on the end of this building. Do you think anybody who drives by doesn't know that Jesus died on the cross? I have an old-fashioned church with a great big steeple and a cross way on the top. Everyone who goes by knows that's where Christians meet, and they talk about Jesus on the cross. But the difference is you believe it. You have taken it to heart by the power of this Holy Spirit working through the Word of Christ. You not only know what happened, but you love it. And you love what your Savior has done for you, and you will love what your Savior has sent to you. Because hand in hand, you will walk with Him as He leads you through this wicked world to life everlasting in Jesus' name. So live in the Word. Live in it daily, constantly. Love the Word. Use it through this man that you call pastor. And you, live in the Word. Be humble. Be a student. Be a gospel preacher. And proclaim to these people the truth of the Word, whether they like it or not. But I bet they're going to love it. To God be the glory. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. And now we turn once again to the bulletin, page 8, and we join to confess our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please stand. We confess, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Pastor, accuse the Lord.
About to be ordained into the ministry and installed as a pastor at Mount of Life take to heart his scriptural words of warning and encouragement, humbly accepting the word planted in you. Work together with him for our Lord's kingdom, so that by your works of service, the body of Christ might be built up. Help him by your word and example in teaching the young, remembering how the scriptures urge you to bring up your children in the training and instruction of the Lord. Honor and love him, as the Apostle Paul says. Respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Pray for him continually, that his ministry among you may be greatly blessed, and with all his responsibilities, he may continue to have a cheerful spirit. Provide also for his physical needs, for the Lord says, the worker deserves his wages. The Apostle Paul says, anyone who receives instruction in the word must share all good things with his instructor. And finally, remember what the scriptures say. Obey your leaders and submit to their authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give account. Obey them so that their work will be a joy and not a burden, for that would be of no advantage to you. I now ask you, therefore, in the presence of God, are you willing to receive your pastor as a minister of God? Will you show him the love, honor, and obedience in the Lord, which you owe to a shepherd and overseer placed over you by the Lord Jesus Christ, the chief shepherd and overseer of souls? If so, answer, we will, and we ask God to help us.
We will, and we ask God to help us.
The almighty and merciful God strengthen and assist you in keeping this promise always. Jared Lindemann, I ordain you as a minister of the church and install you as a pastor at Fount of Life Lutheran Church in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord pour out on you his Holy Spirit for the work committed to you, that you may faithfully proclaim the gospel in word and sacrifice. And now receive the blessings of the Lord through the laying on of hands from your fellow ministers in the gospel. I'll go first. I'm Pastor Phil Kieselhorst from Shepherd of the Valley, Westminster, and also a member of your circuit, so I look forward to studying God's Word with you regularly as we support and encourage each other in the ministry of the Word. In your ministry, keep in mind the blessing of God through the Holy Spirit in Romans 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
My dear son, my favorite, my son in life, in faith, and now in the ministry, I bless you with my favorite passage. You know what it is, and I hope that you come to know it even better than I and to love it. It is Exodus 33, verse 11. And the Lord would talk to Moses as a man speaks with his friend.
Brother Lindemann, I am Pastor James Siles of Salem Lutheran Church right across town. So we are neighboring churches. The ministry is a tremendous blessing, and the joy of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ is the greatest honor in all the world. But there are challenges, there will be troubles, there even persecutions may follow. So I pray that you'll keep in mind these beautiful words from Psalm 27, verse 1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Amen.
Hey, Jared. Tom Engelbrecht from Christ Our Redeemer in Aurora, just a little bit north of here. When Jesus gave his order to his church to carry out their mission, to carry out the ministry, he surrounded that order, that command, with his promises, because he knew it was going to be an overwhelming task for anybody. And so as you carry out your ministry here, and as you carry out the mission along with the beautiful people of Fountain of Life, I get to repeat Jesus' promise for you when he said, "Surely I am with you always to the very end of the age."
We met last week. I'm Pastor Emeritus Boyd Longshore. Pastor Emeritus means I'm retired from the ELS. And it's a great privilege to be here for your ordination and installation. And I can tell you, I've served this church before for 4 months for the vacancy. And there are times that you can get discouraged and you can, you know, kind of be tempted to follow maybe the sinful world. And so I would ask that you would remember these words spoken by Paul to the young pastor Timothy from 1 Timothy 4:16. Watch your life and your doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. God's blessings.
Jared, welcome to the circuit. Glad to have you. And what doesn't seem too long ago, 20 years, that I sat in a similar situation and the overwhelming nature of what it means to be a pastor. And I think there's moments now that I've lived through it of knowing there's overwhelming moments where I needed shelter and I needed the comfort and I needed to know that I had a God who was behind me. And there's moments where in that shelter, enjoying that situation, I needed the strength to go out and do the work that God has called us to do. So I pray that you find comfort in Psalm 46, verse 1. God is a refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Welcome.
David Wietzke, serving just down the road to the south in Pueblo West. You will be my closest neighbor in ministry, so I'm excited to have you here serving in the circuit with me, other than the fact that there are now two Jareds in the circuit, so we'll get past that somehow. What you're embarking on, as others have said too, is an awesome thing. It's an exciting thing. It's a joyful thing. And as the other Jared just said a moment ago, it's also an intimidating thing. And it's okay to admit that. After 20 years, it still is. I can't think of a better prayer and promise for a time like today and for all the Sundays and years thereafter than the one we heard in our first lesson today. God's word to Joshua as he was about to succeed Moses. He promised him, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Joshua 1, verse 9. God bless.
I'm glad you're here. You all know who I am. Words of encouragement that have always stuck with me from the end of Paul's letter to the Corinthians, just in how to go about ministry. It's true for every Christian, but maybe especially true as pastors. It goes like this, 1 Corinthians 16, "Be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be courageous, be strong, do everything in love."
Brother Jared, I'm Daniel Bondo at Living Savior in Littleton, Colorado, and blessed to also be a part of the circuit you're now joining. And as a believer walks through this world by faith and not by sight, so does the believing pastor that shepherds his flock. It is not a process of creativity and ingenuity or even determination that got you here today. It's the grace of our Lord who delivered you safely to this place and presents you with this opportunity for special service to him, to these people who are here. And it's with that in mind that a pastor walks by faith, understanding that there's a Lord of the church who's also a Lord of the universe, one who has in mind every blessing, every challenge, every opportunity, every step of the way, planned and prepared for you and the congregation here. And that's an awesome thing. That's why the wisdom that comes from Proverbs chapter 3 is so pertinent for you today and will be the beating heart of your ministry. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. God be with you.
Martin Valesky from Abiding Word in Highlands Ranch. Jared, you got here at a good time because now you're the new guy, and I only had that title for 1 week, so thank you for taking that very quickly. All of us here, as we're standing here, we desire to be pastors after the Lord's heart, and we have God's promise about the type of pastor and shepherd that he is looking for in Jeremiah. I will send you shepherds after my own heart who will lead you with understanding and knowledge. Jeremiah 3:15. Welcome.
Jared, I'm representing the generation of your grandfather, your late grandfather, Ed, who, in his wisdom a couple years ahead of me, kept me on the straight and narrow through Northwestern College and the seminary. And was a dear friend residing in heaven. And as I enter my 60th year of sharing the gospel as a retired pastor, I want to give you the same word that I got from the Apostle Paul as he wrote to Timothy, writes to all of us, about the easiest job in the world. Only three words: preach the word. God bless you in your ministry as you carry it out with his help and the Holy Spirit's power in your heart. Welcome.
We stand and join in the prayer Jesus taught. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. You may be seated for our final hymn. Thank you. Welcome once again to Fount of Life. I could give a million thank yous right now, but I'll just thank you all, God's people, for coming together today to celebrate the Lord's ministry. After a prayer by Pastor Lindemann, we'll have the ushers dismiss the congregation, and we'll have a meal and fellowship in the atrium.
Thank you. I've been asked to say the meal for the prayer for the meal. We'll be lining up immediately as you are dismissed, so that's why we're going to have the prayer now. We'll ask the pastors to stay for a picture, so everyone else, we'll be the last one, so we can be defrocked or roped after this. So, we join to pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you are good and gracious. In your love and mercy, you sent your dear Savior into this world to take care of our greatest need, the washing away of all of our sins. We thank you for making us your people in his blood, in his resurrection, in his righteousness, and in his name. And in that name, we now ask your blessing upon our meal. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let these gifts to us be blessed. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Amen. Thank you, and Lord's blessings.